Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, step right this way. Tonight, in the big tent, you will see a spectacle never before witnessed by modern man. Tonight, the star attractions are locked in their cages. For tonight, the downtrodden of the new ringmasters.
The liberties by travels look down. Go up and down the big staircase. A secret panel to another place. I saw a guy wear a hockey mask. And he's carrying a bloody ass. He chases me on down the hall. They blow the dripping from off the wall.
A lot of this stuff where they're at nighttime, and when we do our paranormal investigation, we actually cut out that middleman of doing it at the night, and we do it during the day, because being an evil clown and working in the horror business for so long, I know that the dark plays tricks on you. I know that it matrixes things that normally wouldn't be there.
Fill in the blanks.
That scares the bejesus out of you. However, when you take that part out, and you do the investigation during the day, and then you see that shadow figure, that's more credible than someone saying, I saw a shadow figure that you never see on camera. The best thing is, I won't say the show, every time they say, I see a ghost, and they turn around, there's nothing there on the camera, and all you see is nostrils and eyeballs.
But you've got this music in the background, wow, 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 when they turn around and see nothing.
Yeah, exactly. You get all excited, and there it was. I'm not saying these guys have not caught credible footage, which they have. What I'm saying, and I know why a lot of people do it at night, because people are quiet and whatnot.
The spooky factor at night.
Exactly. Because if you filmed a paranormal television show during the day, you probably wouldn't get the response that you would at nighttime. But we have done this before. We have some good footage, and so they will have to take you down to there. A man by the name of Reed Byron, which is down behind Job Lot. And we have caught full apparitions of him in the day. And we've caught full EVPs there in the day. And that place, will, honestly, the hairs will go up on end when you walk in there. It's a creepy cemetery. I haven't heard it, but there's
where
actually...
Is this again?
Don't worry, we'll get to
you
that.
You tell us where you
don't
saw the
don't tell everybody that's going to be watching the show now.
I will not tell where this because I don't because there's a lot of people that go back here and vandalize this. So I never give the site up.
Okay.
I never ever do that because this thing, they're taking a big chance right now. They're cleaning it and making it look nice. They've got a lot of riffraff, but it is very haunted. And one of the reasons I think it's so haunted, when we were younger, there was a lot of stupidity in there. There was a lot of people messing around with satanic rituals in this thing. There was a lot of up in graves, grave robbing, because I personally don't think a spirit is going to stick around and haunt a cemetery where he could be haunted somewhere he likes. However, if you're messing with his burial spot, there is that possibility that he's going to come back and say, hey, you're messing with my burial spot here. This place is very creepy. We'll have to take you down there. Before... And bless all the souls that were lost in this. Before the station night fire, we were out there investigating, and we were doing an interview, and we caught a gentleman sitting behind a headstone, and there was this bright aura behind him. And we kept zooming the camera in, but there was no expression on the face, and there was like you could almost see through the figure. We knew it wasn't the trees. We kept looking at it, saying, "Oh, it's not the trees," but there was definitely someone sitting there watching us. And to this day, we haven't caught that one, but we went down further where someone was crushed by a headstone because they were playing with stuff they weren't supposed to, and the headstone fell over and crushed them. We were filming there, and Deadly Dan caught a pair of legs walking behind him. And it was very creepy, and this is all in the daylight. I'll give you that information later. Have you ever caught in something doing the paranormal investigation where it's made you think, maybe I have overstepped the boundaries just a little bit? Because if you notice, there's a lot more of this stuff coming forth now. You know, there might be that time where you're sitting there and there's Aunt Gertrude and you're going to be interviewing her. Is that going to be the step where you say, okay, maybe this is something I don't want to investigate anymore?
Never. I'm going to do this till the day I die. Hopefully somebody comes looking for my ghost. I don't know what you have to say about overstepping your bounds, Carl. I mean, we don't go into people's houses and overstep our bounds, like bringing Ouija boards or do any provocation or anything like that. Because these folks have to live with these spirits, and we get to go home and say, hey, you know, hope these guys are all right.
Well, in a few instances, I've been in a situation where there's been so much paranormal activity. And, you know, anybody who's done some paranormal investigating is aware that when you're called in to assist with a residential case, somebody's home, generally the person will tell you, oh, so much was happening before your team showed up and now it stopped. And you really don't see much at the time. You may record some EVPs, electronic voice phenomena. You may feel some cold spots, feel that you're not particularly welcome there. And then after the investigating team leaves, they say, oh, all hell broke loose after you guys left. And we started getting touched and lights went on and off. Well, I've been in a few cases where the paranormal activity was manifesting right well when the investigative team was there. And after that goes on for some hours, you feel you really don't belong there. I did feel that I was overstepping my bounds just by being there, but I wanted to inspire confidence in the people who had called us in to explore their situation. So I stood my ground, but in those instances, when we saw crockery flying across the room and actually strike the owner of the house, the lady of the house, one of them hit her, one of these shards of crockery hit her, and you hear bangings on the walls and some really strange anomalies manifest in the photographs. After a while, I felt, you know, I really shouldn't be here, but I need to be. And it was fascinating, especially in retrospect. But I didn't feel emotionally that I belonged there at that time. I felt unwelcome by whatever unseen presence was in that home. That's actually several houses in Rhode Island and New York.
Fair enough. Have you guys ever caught something that has scared you out of there? To the point where, I know there's a lot of paranormal investigators that go in there all brave and stuff when they start off, but then when they catch it, they turn chicken. Have you ever caught anything that has scared you out of the building?
No, that's never happened. I don't expect it ever would.
I've been startled, but I never ran going out. I ran going towards it.
So you never did the dude run thing?
Oh, I don't do the dude run. I'd have to fire myself.
Sorry, Brian. I had to dick you a little bit on that one.
It looks nice on a t-shirt.
Dude run!
I was there for that instance, too.
Yeah. Now, I've seen some of the stuff that you have investigated, and you play with, well, not play with, sorry, excuse that, investigate stuff that, personally, it would scare the bejesus out of me, which is why I haven't done it. The demonology stuff. Now, these are beings that may have been here before Christianity, and they don't take someone too well to people butting their noses into their business. Can you tell us a little more on that? Because that is a creepy subject, personally. I know there's some out there that can manifest themselves as children and think that you have a child in your house, and they can get very, very nasty. And there might have actually been the possibility of some of these causing people to kill themselves. Anybody's takes on this, the demonology?
Well, we don't have really modern or scientific terminology to apply to this study. We say demons, we say spirits, we say hauntings, and the term demon is rather medieval in itself, but it refers to the more hostile, stronger type of spirit. Interestingly, a demonic haunting doesn't last for as long as a human-generated haunting. It usually does its damage over the period of a year, maybe 2 years, but then goes away, then goes somewhere else. So I think my most unsettling experience was in a demonic case, and I'm referred to as a demonologist. I specialize as a demonologist, meaning I'm an expert in the unknown, really, things we don't understand. We don't know what causes them. Demons are thought to be ancient spirits that, as you say, possibly predate the human race. They may be fallen angels, but we know they're here and we know they're malicious. They seem to have agendas. And one case I addressed in Providence, Rhode Island, very early in my career of paranormal investigating, even in that early time, I was known to be a paranormal investigator and somebody who would stand my ground. Well, I was invited into this home where a 14-year-old boy named Lucas was undergoing fits of what they thought might be possession. So I was invited to stay overnight at this house in the west end of Providence. And I had heard that this young boy would go through fits where something seemed to be taking over him. So I had bedded down on the couch, and at about 1 a.m. in the morning one evening, when I was staying overnight there, suddenly I was awoken, as were the rest in the house, by this blood-curdling scream. And I heard thumping, banging, thrashing. So I fumbled for the light in the living room, and the wall light, and flicked on the light, the overhead light. And I and others saw this 14-year-old boy come careening out of his bedroom. And his body was curled up in a fetal position, and he was spinning around at a blurry speed and banging off the walls. It's one thing to talk about this, it's another thing to be standing there frozen in that spot watching it. And I just observed for what seemed like a long time, but it was probably about 20 seconds, as this boy was being thrown against the walls. Then, with a speed that seemed greater than human, he jumped up on the sofa where I had been resting and started to jump up and down, and this harsh laughter came out of his mouth, and he had this wild look in his eyes. I tried to restrain him. I was pretty sturdy, and I was my normal 200-plus pounds. I tried to hold his arms down. He pushed me right off him, and then he came out of this spell, and even if you could explain away what was happening to him as accelerated muscle motor performance, you could tell he wasn't acting this because he was in a panic. And an exorcism was arranged. I participated in this, and that was a very harrowing and trying experience. There were a couple of instances where I thought I would actually go outside and leave. This is too much for me. But I said, no, this is where I either stay with it or I don't do this anymore. So I helped out with that exorcism. It lasted for well over an hour. By the way, when the exorcism procedure began and there was clergy involved, prayers were said, and then we became quiet. And when the actual formal exorcism began, the floor in this parlor room shook as if it was an earth tremor or a truck going by. But there was no detectable source. The floor just shook floorboards. Something heavy and unwholesome entered the room. I can't describe it otherwise, something wrong. And my chair with me in it, I was sitting in the center of a semicircle, just my chair with me seated in it, moved back across the wall, propelled by an unseen force, till I was back against the wall. And then this boy fell onto the floor and went into his seizure-like fits, but cursing, swearing, telling us to leave him alone. Prayers were said, he was doused with holy water, and after that procedure, he was much better. He only had one more episode after that, when he and his parents were driving by a church, and he started to scream, go into a panic when they went by a church. But after that, he seemed much better. It was actually a very complicated case. I could talk about it for an hour. But
I suppose the exorcism succeeded because he was much better after that. I also keep in mind he was in that formative state, that at age 14 he was in his adolescence. His hormones were running wild, I suppose. That affects a person's psychology. He had found a glove in a cemetery in the West End of Providence, and he picked it up and brought it home. It was a woman's glove. Nobody knew why it was there, but then the glove disappeared. Nobody could find it. And it was shortly after that where he started to be taken over by an invading personality. So that actually began my interest in demonology. And it's not for everybody, of course. It's not that I'm stronger or more efficient than maybe other paranormal investigators, but it seemed to find me. It's not that I went out looking for these heavier, these demonic cases. They would be brought to me. So, and the late Ed Warren once said that once someone decides to embark upon the path of demonology, specializes as a demonologist, one is forever marked, that the demonic realm recognizes you and you can't get away from it unless you leave the field altogether.
So you're marked because you're next to an evil clown. Keep that in mind. Haven't heard too much from the young ladies down there. You're very quiet when I talk.
Oh, I'll just keep talking so they don't have to.
This is very interesting about the demon stuff. We're going to go to a little commercial break, and we're going to come back and ask some more paranormal questions.
When you swing, you gotta actually swing with your hips. That's how you get the power behind it.
So on the hips.
There you go. See? That's what I'm saying.
Wait.
No, wait, jazz hands.
No, I'm gonna play T-ball. Come over here and squat down real low.
Wait, excuse me?
I'm playing T-ball here.
You should get down on your knees in front of her so it looks like she's gonna knock
Yes,
your
I should,
off.
By all means.
Don't be dirty!
Not like that, you
sicko. You sicko!
I meant like she's gonna clock you.
Alright, fine.
No, I gotta buy
Watch me actually do it. I hear the Sir Chuck the Clown.
Yeah, thank you very much. Now you're gonna knock my block off.
And his head goes flying! It's out of the park! Show, and this has been a very interesting segment here. We have Carl Johnson, we have Big Rody, and also Paranormal.
Beyond the Veil. Beyond the Veil.
Paranormal. So we've been talking everything spooky, big and furry. We're going to go from, I guess we're told by our director, we're going to go from the spooky back to the big and furry, which is your specialities there. My question at this point, have you done any investigations outside Rhode Island, say like Maine or New Hampshire, where the woods are a little more vast and the thing might actually be living there? I personally think that Bigfoot did come through here and it was just like any other animal migrating out to follow its food source, and it went right back. I think it possibly could be up in New Hampshire, Vermont, or the Maine area, or even New York. The woods in there are big.
I do believe they do migrate, just like most animals do. Like the deer, they seem to disappear when there's no more food sources, when it's like winter. There's no more grass, there's no more leaves, there's no more Bigfoot. And I have investigated in Salt Fork in Ohio, and that's, wow, a lot of sightings out there. I never seen one out there, but I have gone out and investigated in the forest of Salt Fork State Forest.
I heard something interesting today. Someone actually told me the state of Ohio believes in Bigfoot so much that it is illegal to shoot it.
That is true.
They have an ordinance there. It's on the books. But if somebody did shoot a Bigfoot, of course, they could say, well, it was acting in a threatening manner. It was approaching me. I thought it was a bear. They could come up with any number of excuses. But I guess then we'd have our proof of Bigfoot.
I just say I shot in Detroit. So I get shot in Detroit and nothing new. They came at me with guns in Detroit. I shot it. So any of you other young ladies ever experienced the big, tall, and hairy or seen them? Or what got you involved in going to find this creature?
Well, what are you ladies doing down in Hope Valley lately? On horseback, going out on the trails?
Actually, we just started searching for Bigfoot on my property. I have tons of swamplands, lots of overgrowth, laurels, and all that. So we figure, you know, it's not really messed with out there, so there could possibly be a Bigfoot. We have, it's got the old Revolutionary house foundations and all that, good cover, lots of water sources. So we're going to use that to our advantage and hopefully find a Bigfoot.
Have any of you ever thought about, now have you seen these, the deer picture things that they set up on trees?
Trap cameras.
Yes, yes. Have any of you used any of those? Because I noticed, and I'm going to bash these guys again, they'll go to that area and they very rarely use these trap cameras that these things are spotted at. And if they do, they only use it for a day. Personally, if I think that critter's there, I'm going to investigate it more than a day. I'm probably going to have those things up every day to see if I can catch it. Because if that's where it's eating, eventually it's going to return there. But they don't give it time. They just say, oh, I put it up in a day, and it's not here. We're done.
I did have a team member. He's no longer on our team, but he did have a trap camera. And he put it out there for about a week, and, well, there was nothing on it.
This critter could be intelligent enough to know that you actually do have a camera. I mean, it is a primate, ladies and gentlemen.
Well, they are smarter than we give them credit for. I mean, I think they're going to show themselves to the people that they want to show themselves to. I don't think they're just going to run out to just anybody and show themselves. I saw Bigfoot for a reason. He came to me. I didn't go to him.
Personally, why would these things want to be found? I mean, look what happened to those silverback gorillas. They thought they were extinct. And then when we found out they existed, we now go out and hunt them to cut their hands off. So why would this thing want to come down to be found? Because humans, like us evil clowns, are brutal. And if you found one of these things, they'd probably stick it in a zoo somewhere, dissect it, or find it, put it on a hunting list. So it's obviously smart enough where not only does it invade us, but it has invaded this country's best hunters, the Native Americans.
Native Americans actually have seen, there's a lot of reports that mostly Native Americans have seen the Bigfoot or Sasquatch. Because the Native Americans are very spiritual people, and I believe, in a sense, that Bigfoot is spiritual in a different sense. Not on our level, but in a different way.
Now, I've heard another theory on this, and I want to see what you guys think, that Bigfoot actually might be a missing link to humans. It might actually be that in between caveman and ape link, and it didn't go extinct like human beings thought. It might have actually stayed where it was and learned to stay away from the Cro-Magnon, especially seeing what we did to the woolly mammoth and everything else that was on this planet. They may have decided that, hey, this breed of primates is very violent, and we're going to choose to stay away from them. What do you think about that theory at all?
Well, Dina, when you had that personal sighting, and this was about 7 feet away from you, and it was dusk, you told me, were you looking at a gorilla, or were you looking at a feral human?
It
what did you see?
More man, like more man than any gorilla. It looked more like a man, just hairier.
And they don't have those ape-like feet for grasping, with a prehensile toe. They
more
have
human.
More
human-like more
human. Feet.
It didn't have the monkey face. It had more like a man face, just hairier.
And if we look at reconstructions of some of the ancestral human types, the hominids, like Homo heidelbergensis, even the Neanderthalic types, they look different from us, but they're still of us. They're human in that way.
I called it a monster man. I thought it was a monster, but a man. I didn't know what it was. I was 16 years old. We didn't have those cable shows finding whatever that show is. And, Monster Quest and all that. We didn't have that back then. So, and access to the internet, that was unheard of. So I didn't know what it was.
I think one of the reasons you're seeing a lot more of this stuff, too, is because it's no longer, you're a weirdo. It used to be a couple of years back, you started talking about Bigfoots or ghosts or anything paranormal. You were stuck in the corner and you were weird. Now it's politically okay to say, I've seen this.
Yeah, but we're still weird. So
yeah, but that's why I love you, because we're all weird.
We're strange.
That's why we're here. That brought us together. Yeah, but it's popularized now. When Keith, my brother and I were in junior high school, yeah, we were somewhat ostracized because we had those interests in, what's the truth behind monsters? Are there spirits? And, we would talk to people about it and investigate in cemeteries even back then. So, word get around, those Johnson twins, they're interested in strange things. But now, ghost hunting is popularized. It's the thing to do. People want to find out what's beyond the veil, what makes these things work. Why are people seeing spirits? Why do some people report seeing hairy man-like creatures out in the woods? And there are enough reports coming in, and now it's more openly spoken of that people aren't so embarrassed about it anymore. Those of us who specialize in it, though, we're still a little bit on the lunatic fringe by, scientific standards.
Well, you know what? We're all pretty much the same in this field because nobody really knows what's going on. What is Bigfoot? What is a ghost? Do we really know what it is? Is anybody really an expert in the field? I really don't think so. I don't think anybody's an expert in this field. Yeah. We do it because we want proof for ourselves about Bigfoot. I want to prove to them, I saw this, and you're going to see it too. And I'm going to take pictures, but I'm going to leave the location undisclosed because I'm not going to tell anybody where I seen it.
Yeah, Galileo and Columbus, Magellan, they had some pretty wild ideas too. Somebody has to sacrifice themselves, so to speak. Somebody has to get out there, do the research, do the speculating, take chances, and risk being socially ostracized.
Okay, shh. Listen to this. This is the tape I found downstairs.
We'll be right back. God. God.